Greetings and welcome. Bienvenidas y bienvenidos. Mi nombre es Rodolfo Felices Luna y soy profesor adjunto de Sagrada Escritura en la Escuela de Estudios Superiores de Teología de los Oblatos de María Inmaculada. My name is Rodolfo Felices Luna and I am Assistant Professor of Sacred Scripture at Oblate School of Theology. You are viewing the first installment of The Bible and Its Tradition on the Sunday of the Word of God. Está usted viendo el primer episodio de la Biblia y su tradición sobre el Domingo de la Palabra de Dios. This is a joint project to foster bilingual understanding of the Bible and its tradition from a Catholic perspective. We will discuss questions that you may have when you read the Bible or hear the Word of God proclaimed. Este es un proyecto para fomentar un entendimiento bilingüe de la Biblia y su tradición desde el punto de vista católico. Abordaremos interrogantes que quizás le surjan a usted cuando lee la Biblia o escucha la palabra de Dios proclamada. Now, whenever Spanish is spoken, closed captions will be available in English. De ahora en adelante, cuando se hable en inglés, se podrán leer los subtítulos en español. Somos cuatro especialistas de la Biblia de dos de las mejores instituciones católicas aquí en San Antonio, Texas. Los profesores Todd Hanneken y Allison Gray de la Universidad St. Mary's, y la profesora Renata Furst y su servidor de la Escuela de Superior de Teología de los Oblatos. Nos hemos juntado a fin de ofrecerles una serie de talleres para familiarizarse más con la Biblia y su tradición. En este primer episodio, comentamos las lecturas del tercer domingo ordinario, el Domingo de la Palabra de Dios. Thanks to our generous Catholic supporters, this is all available to you at no cost. We invite you to visit our website, share it at will, and follow us to keep yourself informed of future events. Now let us begin. Empecemos, pues.
This video is part of a larger project that is designed to increase understanding about the Bible and about approaches to biblical interpretation. We scholars hope to share some of what we do in the theology classroom with lay people and ministers in Catholic parishes. We hope this series will fuel your love of learning about the Word of God and that together all of us will be inspired to explore the richness of Scripture. If you're in the San Antonio area, we invite you to join us for upcoming live events. In May 2021, we will consider the role of Mary and scriptural portraits of the Mother of Christ. In October 2021, we will think about young adult members of our Catholic community. What does Scripture call young adults to do, and how can the Word of God empower them to answer that call? Our December 2021 focus will be the season of Advent and biblical texts about joyful hope. All of these live events will be recorded, edited, and published online in Inglés y Español to be shared widely.
We're so happy to be introducing the series in time for the 2021 Sunday of the Word of God. The Sunday of the Word of God was instituted as part of our annual liturgical year by Pope Francis fairly recently in September 2019. This is a new way of calling us back to our center near the beginning of every year. We theology professors have the joy of studying and teaching Scripture every week. We want everyone to have that opportunity. If we want to celebrate the Sunday of the Word of God, we should start by thinking about what is the Word of God? The answer is not as simple as the Bible. If I say Word of God in Latin, Dei Verbum, the first thing that comes to mind is the 1965 culminating document of the Second Vatican Council. But of course, Dei Verbum is not the Word of God. It is a document by bishops about the Word of God. Its longer title is Dogmatic Constitution on Divine Revelation. So Dei Verbum is a document about God made known to human beings, but we're still not at the Bible. The Word of God is first and foremost Christ, the second person of the Trinity. The Gospel of John starts with this important point. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That Word became flesh in Jesus of Nazareth. Later in this series, we'll get back to why Word, Palabra, is an appropriate title for Christ, and how Paul, John, and the Nicene Creed find Christ revealed in the books of Proverbs and Genesis, where all things are created through words. As Catholics, we believe that Christ is sacramentally present with us. But we say that about the Eucharist, not about the Bible. We don't adore the Bible the way we adore the Blessed Sacrament. When we hold a Bible in our hands, we are not holding Christ. Christ is revealed through Scripture, but it takes work. That work is interpretation. The Human Document from 1965 about the Word of God teaches us that the Bible is itself a collection of human documents about the Word of God. The key phrase is, the words of God expressed in human language. Las palabras de Dios expresadas con lenguas humanas. So if we want to understand Christ through Scripture, we also need to understand the humans who expressed in their own languages, their own tongues, how Christ was revealed to them. The Bible is not merely human words, and it is not in itself God. Much as we believe that Jesus of Nazareth is fully God and fully human, we must approach Scripture as both divine revelation and human expression. That is not an easy task, but we have help. The bishops of the Second Vatican Council, the Pontifical Biblical Commission, and other documents guide us in the awe-inspiring task of finding Christ in Scripture. The first and most important concept to learn is that in the Catholic tradition, we are committed to interpreting Scripture in context. By context, we mean many things. We mean a verse in the context of the chapter or the rest of the book. We mean a book in the context of the rest of the books. We mean both testaments, and yes, we find Christ revealed in both testaments. We also mean the context of the human authors. We mean the context of all who have gone before us as interpreters of Scripture, such as Saints Jerome and Augustine. We mean the context of our teachers today, and especially our bishop and those who support his work. We also mean the context of the lectionary, in which different parts of Scripture are presented in the context of each other and the context of the Mass. We mean our families and our parish communities and the parish groups that gather to help each other find Christ in Scripture in all these contexts. These contexts of family, parish, teachers, bishops, saints are collectively what we call our tradition. It is important to remember that in Catholicism, we do not approach Scripture alone. We do not think we can understand the Bible by ourselves. If the task is to understand God revealed, we need both Scripture and tradition, and understand that ultimately they cannot be separated because they come from the same source. This series will draw from the expertise of professional Bible scholars, especially for historical and literary context, but always with an eye to the other context that these scholars share with all Catholics. For the next segment, let's look at the context of the lectionary for the Sunday of the Word of God.
This Sunday of the Word of God seems to be the perfect timing to reflect upon what the Word of God actually says to us. Today's Gospel, according to Mark, has Jesus summarized his message in four pithy statements. One, this is the time of fulfillment. Two, the kingdom of God is at hand. Three, repent. And four, believe in the gospel. What did Jesus mean by that? Comencemos con la primera afirmación. Se ha cumplido el tiempo. Doctora Gray, usted se especializa en griego, el idioma en el que fue escrito el Evangelio. ¿Cuál es el trasfondo griego detrás de las palabras tiempo y se ha cumplido? ¿Qué traducciones serían posibles en inglés? ¿Cuál es la idea general tras esta afirmación y cómo expresarla en inglés?
Looking at the Greek always helps me see these phrases in new ways. The word for time is kairos, and it can mean time in the general, the sense of a general period of time, or it can mean the opportune time, that moment you want to seize before it passes. When we bring an idea like the opportune time, together with the verb plero'o, which means fulfill or complete, this phrase can mean something like the moment has come. The claim that something is being fulfilled also makes a connection between the present moment and the past, looking back to promises God has made throughout history. Jesus is announcing that the thing they've all been waiting for is at hand, and it's time to act. Dr. Luna, how is that rendered in Spanish?
La traducción de la liturgia es, se ha cumplido el tiempo. También es así en la Biblia de la Iglesia en América, pero en orden más sencillo, el tiempo se ha cumplido. La Biblia Latinoamérica dice, el plazo está vencido. Algo así como, se acabó el tiempo o ya llegó la hora. Para mí, todo esto implica que se esperaba algo desde hace mucho tiempo, sin que nadie supiera para cuándo exactamente. Y Jesús declara que ya llegó la hora, el momento indicado o el tiempo previsto por Dios. Da una sensación de urgencia e implica que ya no se puede retroceder. Las frases siguientes anuncian el reino de Dios o la victoria de Dios, así que uno podría atravesarse inclusive a traducir, se acabó. Los enemigos de Dios no pueden continuar ganando la batalla. Vienen mejores tiempos y ya están aquí. Esto implica también una crítica de cómo han ido las cosas últimamente, es decir, mal, no según el plan de Dios, quien cuenta con rectificarlas y provocar el cambio. Sin embargo, según San Marcos, Jesús dijo esto hace 2000 años. ¿Seguiremos todavía en este kairos o ya se nos pasó el tiempo?
Christians live with this tension between already and not yet. I'm sure you've heard this phrasing. We are a people with eschatological expectations. We anticipate that Jesus will return and that the rule of God will be present in a new way at the end of time, the eschaton in Greek. Yet we are invited to work every day to make our living community and our whole world a better and better reflection of God's rule, more just, more loving, more hopeful today. This reminds me of someone like St. Francis of Assisi, who wanted to model his life around 1100 after the lives of the apostles, by giving up his goods and sharing all things in common within the community. In his mind, the time for living out gospel teaching is always now. It's always the opportune moment. But that eschaton is still coming. Even decades after the resurrection of Christ, Paul tells Christians in Corinth that the time is running out, as we hear in the second reading today. How come we haven't run out of time 20 centuries later?
Todo es cuestión de perspectiva, del tiempo o de la calidad de tiempo que se tiene, no de la cantidad de tiempo que queda. El tiempo parecía alargarse por siempre, mientras que Israel esperaba al santo de Dios, al ungido de Dios, al Mesías. Ahora que Cristo ha cumplido su misión, que ha muerto por nosotros y ha resucitado, el tiempo se nos hace corto, sin estalmenos en griego. Y la manera de vivir de este mundo está vencida, caduca, obsoleta, desfasada, desapareciendo. Aunque sigamos viviendo en este mundo aún lleno de injusticia, de odio, de opresión, de mal descarado, nuestro anhelo por un mundo nuevo en el cual vivir, un mundo de justicia, de paz, de liberación y de buena voluntad, no queda desesperanzado o desilusionado, sino lleno de la esperanza de Pascua Florida, marcado por ella. San Pablo nos llama a vivir desfasados con el mundo que se va y en fase con el nuevo mundo que llega, vuelcos hacia el reino de Dios, dejando caer los valores mundanos, los esquemas en griego, schema, que comprometen la calidad de vida de nuestro prójimo. Debemos desligarnos de dichos esquemas y renovar nuestra manera de pensar y de actuar, viendo al tiempo como a nuestro aliado, favorable al reino de Dios en el nuevo mundo, en vez de verlo como un enemigo que retardara su irrupción o su consumación.
Looking ahead to the Lenten season, maybe we can re-examine how we are thinking about time. Are we still trying to seize the moment and use this opportune time to bring our community in line with the rule of God? How do we rediscover for ourselves and our communities the new quality of time Jesus and Paul spoke of as good news for the people? Well, this is all very interesting, but we've run out of time ourselves discussing this topic. Let's turn to Professor Todd Hannikin and the second statement in today's gospel on the kingdom of God.
I can't think of the last time I used the word kingdom when I wasn't talking about ancient history or the Bible. What comes to mind when you hear the word kingdom? What about kingdom of God? In the days of Jesus and Mark, the kingdom was the Roman Empire, and the Romans didn't let anyone forget it. The kingdom of God meant not that, not the Roman Empire. Before Jesus said anything about it, which he certainly did, his audience had an image of what the kingdom of God would be like based on Daniel chapter 7. And what an image it was, a vision even. There the phrase is not exactly kingdom of God, but kingdom of God's holy ones. The problem was that the Romans were not a new problem. Before the Romans, there was the Seleucid Greeks, then the Ptolemaic Greeks, the Persians, the Babylonians. All of those were powerful, but they were not all-powerful like God. They were almighty, but they were not the Almighty. In the eyes of God's people, they were anything but holy. So why should God's people be ruled by unholy kingdoms? Maybe a little bit of exile is punishment for sin, but surely God has plans to fix the political situation. Daniel sees in his vision the solution. As I watched in the night visions, I saw one like a son of man coming on the clouds of heaven. And he came to the Ancient One and was presented before him. To him was given dominion and glory and kingship that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion and shall not pass away. And the kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. An angel explains the vision to Daniel. But the holy ones of the Most High shall receive the kingship to possess it forever and ever. Then the kingship and dominion and majesty of all the kingdoms under the heavens shall be given to the people of the holy ones of the Most High, whose kingship shall be an everlasting kingship, whom all dominions shall serve and obey. Notice that Daniel still expects there to be dominion and kingship, just aligned better with who deserves it. I don't think the original audience thought of this as a spiritual escape from corrupt earthly politics, or even an end to earthly politics. Just a good reversal. So was Daniel silly to think that politics here on earth could change that much? That politics could be holy, and the people in charge could govern in a holy way over all creatures? Maybe, but it was silly to expect the people of Nineveh, the capital of the great Assyrian Empire, to repent so radically just because the reluctant prophet Jonah said that they should. It was silly to think that two brothers would abandon their father, their boat, and their profession just because some dude with a halo called. Change is possible, if you can believe that. Christians never let go of the idea that the Son of Man would come on the clouds in glory to establish justice, as Daniel saw. But Jesus did a lot more to teach us about the kingdom of God. And much of that will be unpacked over the continuation of this series. We know what Mark knows and what the first hearers of Jesus did not know. When Jesus says the kingdom of God is at hand and Jesus is at hand, then the kingdom of God can be at hand wherever and whenever Jesus is at hand. So maybe the kingdom of God is more than just not the Romans, a point that would require renewed reflection as the Roman Empire continued longer than expected, then became predominantly Christian, then collapsed. But if the kingdom of God is at hand, what does that mean for us? Are we God's holy ones? Is it easy to be a citizen of the kingdom of God? Are we ready for that? I think Daniel had it right at the end of the vision. I, Daniel, was greatly terrified by my thoughts, and my face became pale.
¿Cómo nos ayudan a preparar la cuaresma las lecturas del domingo de la palabra de Dios? Jesús dice en Marcos 1:15, el tiempo se ha cumplido, El reino de Dios está aquí. Conviértanse y crean en la buena noticia. ¿Cómo se entra en el reino de Dios? Como escuchamos, Marcos nos dice que el momento propicio ha llegado para tomar conciencia. El reino de Dios está cerca y por esta razón vamos a explorar lo que significan las palabras conviértanse o arrepiéntanse en las lecturas del domingo de la palabra de Dios. La palabra traducida como conversión en castellano es metanoia en griego, que significa repensar, cambiar de idea, reconsiderar. Esta palabra también la traducimos con arrepiéntanse. En el Antiguo Testamento existen dos palabras que se usan para hablar del cambio interior y exterior de la persona. Naham significa sentir tristeza, duelo, arrepentirse. Y shuv, que significa dar la vuelta, reorientarse o ser restaurado. Vamos a ver tres casos en que el Evangelio de Marcos usa estos sentidos. Primero, al proceso intelectual de metanoia, repensar o reconsiderar, el trasfondo hebreo de la palabra añade el sentido emotivo de sentir tristeza, duelo o arrepentirse. Si añadimos estas palabras a la cita de Marcos, suena así. El tiempo se ha cumplido, el reino de Dios está cerca. Repiensen, sientan tristeza, hagan duelo, arrepiéntanse y crean en la buena noticia. Segundo, en otros capítulos del Evangelio de Marcos, la palabra hebrea shuv, epístrofo en Marcos, que comúnmente se traduce como conviértase, existe en el sentido de dar la vuelta o reorientarse. En Marcos 4:12, Jesús cita a Isaías 6, del 9 al 10, cuando habla de la falta de comprensión de la gente que lo rodea. Por más que miran, no ven. Por más que oigan, no entienden. No sea que se conviertan, que se den la vuelta, se reorienten y sean perdonados. Finalmente, el sentido de ser restaurado o sanado ocurre en los momentos en que Jesús cura a una persona. En Marcos 8:25, escuchamos que restaura la vista de un ciego. Repensar, arrepentirse, sentir duelo, dar la vuelta, reorientarse, convertirse, ser restaurado. El Evangelio de Marcos emplea un rico vocabulario para describir el proceso de cambiar de dirección y entrar en el reino de Dios. También el libro de Jonás y Salmo 25, que son lecturas de este domingo de la palabra de Dios, añaden más detalle a nuestra comprensión del arrepentimiento. El libro de Jonás nos da una imagen del impacto de la palabra de Dios en el proceso de conversión. Los ninivitas, conocidos por su cultura violenta y belicosa, escuchan la proclamación de Jonás y responden. Todos los ninivitas, grandes y chicos, escuchan la proclamación. Proclamaron un ayuno y se vistieron con ropa de penitencia. El texto reitera la palabra shuv con su sentido de dar la vuelta. Describe las acciones de los habitantes de la gran ciudad violenta, esta gente enemiga, cuyos gobernantes en el siglo 8 antes de Cristo habían borrado de la faz de la tierra el reino del norte de Israel. Esta gente escuchó, creyó y actuó. Ellos se arrepintieron. El proceso de reconsiderar, arrepentirse y dar la vuelta es el comienzo de la conversión. Hay que entrar en el reino de Dios, pero también hay que aprender a permanecer en el reino. El Salmo 25, del 4 al 5, expresa la ayuda de Dios que necesitamos para que las raíces de la conversión crezcan en nuestras vidas. Descúbrenos, Señor, tus caminos. Guíanos con la verdad de tu doctrina. Tú eres nuestro Dios y Salvador, y tenemos en ti nuestra esperanza. Permanecer en el reino de Dios es como pertenecer a la casa o familia de Dios. El sentir tristeza, duelo o arrepentirse cobra un significado mucho más personal. Arrepentirse significa dolerse por todo aquello que nos aparta de Dios y de su familia. Para nosotros los hispanos, pertenecer a una familia es un valor fundamental, y estas lecturas nos dan las pautas para entrar y permanecer en el reino.
Y así llegamos, pues, al segmento final del Evangelio de hoy en Marcos capítulo 1, versículo 15. La última frase que resume la enseñanza de Jesús según San Marcos es: crean en el Evangelio. Believe in the gospel, según la New American Bible y la liturgia en inglés. La New Revised Standard Version la traduce como believe in the good news, crean en la buena noticia. Entonces, doctora Gray, ¿de dónde viene la palabra gospel en inglés? ¿Y qué es lo que quiere decir?
The English word is a combination of good and spell or story, and that itself is a neat translation from the original Greek term euangelion. In Mark 1:1, the author writes the beginning of the euangelion, and we translate that word as gospel. It literally means eu, good, plus angelion, message or news. Fun Greek fact, an angelos is a messenger who brings news to a group of people. And you can think about all the biblical angels who make important announcements. The gospel or euangelion is a good message to hear and reflect upon. Isn't that rendered evangelio in Spanish very much like the Greek, Dr. Luna?
Así es. En la traducción litúrgica, evangelio está calcado del griego evangelion. Ahora bien, la Biblia de la Iglesia en América traduce buena noticia, y la Biblia Latinoamérica traduce buena nueva, para reflejar el sentido más prosaico de la expresión, como good news en inglés. Nuestro gospel en inglés, o evangelio en español, se han vuelto conceptos religiosos clave, pero para entender lo que significan, es bueno regresar al sentido secular en su contexto de origen. Doctora Gray, ¿se puede encontrar su uso en la Biblia antes de Jesús? ¿O inclusive fuera de la Biblia, en el mundo de la antigüedad?
The idea of a joyful proclamation or good news is usually a political proclamation in the ancient world. In Isaiah 52:7, we see the herald of God coming to Jerusalem and taking over power, bringing salvation to the people. Good news had a similar valence in the Roman Empire, where messengers often proclaimed that the emperor was about to arrive in a city. The visit of a powerful emperor who had military authority and the favor of the Roman gods was good news for Roman citizens. He could protect them and offer peace. The Emperor Augustus was constantly making announcements and even monuments to share the good news that he had established peace, a Pax Romana, in the Mediterranean region. So when Mark says the story of Jesus's life and death is good news, he's setting Jesus up as an alternative source of protection, peace, and power. The announcement that the opportune moment is here in our reading today should be read as a political announcement about God's rule.
Entonces, pues, si ese es el contexto de origen de la expresión buenas noticias, Quiere decir que Jesús nos invita a creer en lo que Dios es capaz de realizar en nuestras vidas y en las vidas de las personas que nos rodean. No nos está pidiendo que creamos a ciegas en verdades religiosas, valores o principios, tanto como nos está sacudiendo de nuestra inercia, nuestra indiferencia, nuestro conformismo con la manera como las cosas van en este mundo, nuestro sopor o nuestra desilusión, según el contexto de vida de cada uno. Jesús nos está invitando a comprometernos con el nuevo reino de Dios, a ser partícipes del cambio en este mundo. Los cristianos no debemos simplemente de creer en el cielo como el lugar en el que Dios es rey, el reino de Dios allá arriba, como nuestro destino final, nuestra recompensa, sino que debemos convertir nuestra mirada, la manera de vivir en este mundo, y creer que podemos vivir desde ya, de ahora en adelante, como si Dios hubiese tomado control de nuestras vidas, como si Dios gobernara este mundo. Inclusive rezamos, vénganos tu reino, lo que quiere decir, sé nuestro rey. Dirígenos ya, Señor, aquí en la tierra como lo es en el cielo. El Evangelio no es pues solo un concepto religioso en el que creemos, es un evento de transformación del mundo en el que participamos.
And so a Lenten plan for ourselves and our communities could be to rise from our slumber and take action. It's easy to get stuck in indifference or become complacent with the way things happen. But what is comfortable and familiar for us isn't necessarily God's way. I want to go back to today's psalm in verse 9 to think about God's approach. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. When we listen and reflect humbly, we can hear the euangelion, the good news, that now is the time for conversion, to change the way we think and believe. Lent is an opportunity to open our hearts and welcome the disruption of God in our lives as good news, news from heaven for our time and world.
We hope you enjoyed this video. This is the start of a series of in-person events and online resources. You can find all the information at labiblia.stmartx.edu. There you can find the latest on in-person events in San Antonio planned for May, October, and December of 2021. Online registration will be available at least a month in advance. Videos and resources, such as study guides, will be available following those events. You'll also find ways to connect to the professors and other eager learners through social media. That address, again, is labiblia.stmartx.edu. Thank you for engaging in these ideas with us. And thank you to our sponsors, the Catholic Biblical Association, the Confraternity of Christian Doctrine, the Oblate School of Theology, and St. Mary's University.